If you detain me.
Thank you.
Lay me down. pray. O God, giver of new life, we gather this morning with our alleluias, our banners, and flowers, and trumpets and song. Today, Lent is ended, and the time of our salvation has begun. Snow is melting, the flowers are blooming. We come to worship you in beauty and in truth. We come because we have hope that the resurrection will enter into each of our lives and transform them. Through Christ's Spirit, we have come to love one another. This is what you showed us on the first Easter when you raised your Son from the dead, your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Let us say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. Got a new speaker system. Just get a bar.
The moon and stars, they meet. The morning sun will stand. The Savior of the world was found. His body on the cross. His blood poured out for us. The weight of
Glory. have Jesse Bill to give you a message.
Good morning.
Good morning.
See, my favorite thing to do is I pretty much wrote out word for word what I want to say. Let's start off by praying together. Dear God, I thank you for this time together. Let's come together and praise you in your creation, to worship in your presence. In the morning of your son's resurrection, Lord, may be bold for you to accept his kingdom for us on this day. So, I pray that you let nothing come out of my mouth this morning, that you will not bless, Lord, and let us all lead to confessing to Christ be with us, Christ be with us, Christ be with you, Christ be with you, Christ beside you, Christ be with you, Christ be with you, Christ be quiet, and Christ be with you, Christ in the heart of all that love you, Christ in the heart of mouth, or Christ in the mouth of friend and stranger, in your son's name. So I pray that hopefully that's already the prayer of your heart, and if not, hopefully after you hear this sermon, I hope it is, Christ should be at the forefront of everything we do, especially the morning where Christ's power, his love, his wisdom, his strength, his compassion, his majesty, his holiness, insert whatever adjective you want, was fully on display. Christ took to the cross in you and I's place and withstood sin's punishment. And not only did he stand in our place, but he defeated the grave for us. And it was so important for Christ to do that because we were the ones that messed it up. And I think the passage that best sums it up, kind of the basis for the whole message, is Romans 3:23, if you have your Bible, you can translate it. But I'll read it for you. For all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace and through the redemption that came in Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice because of his forbearance. He had left sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did this to demonstrate his justice at the present time so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. I don't think there's probably a better passage that sums up the cross better. Probably really the whole message of the Bible. We have all sinned and we've all fallen short. Every one of us sinned, and we brought forth the need to the cross. When God created Adam and Eve, we fully reveled in God's glory and in his justice and his perfect nature and his almighty power. He is and still is, and he is and was at that time the almighty and powerful God, and we put him first in everything we did. We worship in his glory until one day we decided that the world treasure was better than God's glory. All it took was that. Romans 1 verse 23, although they claimed to be wise, they became foolish, and they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals. When Adam and Eve were created, they had the ultimate treasure. They loved God, they glorified him, they put him first in everything they did, but they betrayed God for this world. Every single one of us betrayed God. In fact, we do it every single day when we sin. And sin is not anything that's outside of us. We have a tendency to justify our sin by saying, oh, mine's not as bad as somebody else's, and my sin, I don't sin that often or whatever, but everybody sins, and it's not just your run-of-the-mill sins, like lying, cheating, stealing, etc. I love the way Pastor John Piper puts it, sin is anything that reflects that God is not your treasure, but sin is your treasure. Sin is the first thought of the unsaved man. We threw away the ultimate gift from the righteous God. While God is a perfect, holy, just judge, we are sinful and rotten to our core. And without the cross, we totally lack any way to get to God. Genesis 6 says, then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on earth, that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was of evil continually. So whoever the greatest among us was, they are sinful, rotten, and evil to the core. So how could God, who is a perfect and righteous judge, all-knowing and perfect judge, allow for people like you and I to gain entrance into his perfect and righteous kingdom. God needed a way to demonstrate his justice. His righteousness is power. He's the rock. He is perfect, for all his ways are just, a God of faithfulness and without injustice. Righteous and upright is he. That's Deuteronomy 32:4. That's where Christ and the cross enter the picture. can you think of a better way to prove your righteousness and your power than to send your only perfect and blameless son to die a sinner's death that he absolutely did not deserve, only to 3 days later forever defeat the grave and sin, and to rise again and give those who trust in him a passage to eternal life? When God does something, he certainly doesn't pull any punches. You can look around at the beautiful creation that we're standing in right now. The cross was God's way to demonstrate his justice, because of its forbearance, he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. God would not be a God of justice, a God without faithfulness, or without injustice without the cross. So think about it, the most respected judge in today's world, probably Judge Judy, if anyone else knows that. She had a rapist and a murderer in front of her, just let him go. We would all get crazy if we didn't respect her as a judge. God, if he would have let her sins without the cross go, he wouldn't be the God of righteousness that he is. The cross was God's loudest statement that God loves his glory, that God loves his people. He is who he says he is. He is a righteous and just God, and he loves his people so much that by faith in his son, Jesus Christ, in the bloodshed, that all our sins can be forgiven. We spend eternity with that righteous God. Not through anything that we did, but what God did. If someone asks you how you know you were saved, and your response has the word, I did this, I did that, you might have a problem. God, through his son's death, bloodshed, and resurrection, granted us grace, his grace, and his mercy, that our sins and our evil can be wiped away, never to be brought up again. And it's not that God simply has amnesia or just forgets our sins. Our record books are continually wiped clean. God repeatedly hits the reset button for us. There was once actually this rich English gentleman some time ago who was looking for his next car, and at that time Rolls-Royce was advertising their car as the car that will never break down. They said you will never have an issue or a breakdown with your Rolls-Royce. So being a rich man that he was, he decided to purchase his Rolls-Royce, obviously at a high dollar amount. But one day he was driving through the countryside and his car actually broke down. So he immediately called Rolls-Royce and said, "You said this car would never break down, and it has." So Rolls-Royce actually put their best mechanic on a plane, on a helicopter, and flew him out to this gentleman. The mechanic fixed the car, sight on scene, and both he and the English gentleman go on their way. The English gentleman goes home, and some time passes while he's expecting to get a large bill for the repair. You know, it's not every day that you have a mechanic flown out to you, but he never receives one. So finally, one day, he calls Rolls-Royce about it. You know, he's a wealthy man and he hates being in debt to somebody, so he just wants to pay his bill and move on from it. But when he called Rolls-Royce and he talks to the head service advisor, the service advisor says, "I'm sorry, sir, but Rolls-Royce has absolutely no record of anything bad ever happening to your car." That's what the cross offers us, complete and total forgiveness of our sins. When we confess our sins to the holy and just God, he responds, "I'm sorry, sir, but I have absolutely no record of anything bad ever happening in your life." Praise God. That type of forgiveness is worth leaving everything that this world has to offer, putting your total and complete life in God's hand, dying to yourself and picking up a cross and following after him. When the disciples questioned Jesus about who can be his disciple, he said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and pick up their cross and follow me." Jesus had to have radical obedience to his God and his Father to have our sins saved. Remember that Jesus, being both fully God and fully human, struggled with going to the cross. I think we always forget that Jesus was just like you and me. He had the same trepidations about getting beaten, mocked, ridiculed, spit on, tortured, hung on a cross by nails through his hands, and died like a common criminal. He was not looking forward to this. He had all the same emotions that you and I had, and at any point he could have annihilated all the people that were persecuting him. He could have jumped down off the cross. He could have taken the whip and started beating the soldiers with that, but he didn't. And he's fair to say that in his position we wouldn't have taken that punishment. Jesus prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me." In the garden, he was in absolute agony, knowing what he was about to endure. Jesus prayed multiple times for this cup to be taken from him. It was God's will for this to happen. And he prayed for his God's will, not his will to be done. That is an absolutely radically devoted son to his Father. That is how you and I gain the passage and access to eternal life. for our sins to be forgiven. So why would anything less from us to Christ gain us access into his kingdom? Why would casual acceptance be enough to enter into God's kingdom? Why would simply praying a prayer, filling out a card, meeting with a pastor, whatever you want to do, be enough to, and then returning to your life that looks just like the world, be enough to gain you access into the kingdom that took so much to gain? Well, if you believe in the gospel, it's probably not enough. Throughout the gospel, when Jesus is asked what it takes to truly follow him, he says things like, pick up a cross and follow me. And in those times when Jesus says that, a cross was not something that people were wearing around their neck or putting on the back of their car. It was an instrument of torture. It'd be the same to you and I coming in with an electric chair around our neck. He says, sell everything you own and give it to the poor and follow me. So remove every obstacle, every money that's keeping you from me, and follow me. He says to hate your own father and mother and follow me. So don't let anyone keep you from me. To follow me, you must eat of my flesh. And with that, with all that being said, can we look at our lives and say that we are truly devoted to Christ? Is our money or our churches or our jobs, every aspect of our life in God's hands? I don't have all the answers, but I think I know if it was, the Church in America would look a lot differently than it would today. We wouldn't be concerned with who has the greatest facilities, who has the greatest speakers, the greatest worship leader, the guitar player, who has the website, the greatest program, the best adult and youth ministry, nicest lounge, best coffee shop, whose service hours are most convenient for our schedules, all while moving who is devoted to Christ and his word and developing the relationship that God so desires of us, down to about 15th or so on the list of what to look for in a church. Only when we as Christians change our attitudes and start to change our lives to look differently than that of the world, will the world start